the 60 songs that Ringer considers essential to explaining the 90s. Volume 2 for us, getting into it. as we the 13th song. And condolences to the family and in remembrance of, as we record this, I believe 2 days ago, the passing at the young age of 56, is that right, of Sinead O'Connor. Nothing so, compares to you.
Love this song. I'm on the record many times over on multiple recordings with Daniel and probably a few with Cass at this point of my fondness of a little short haircut on a pretty face, right? And this video is one of those definitive videos. She's beautiful in this video and singing the song beautifully.
It is a great version of the song, and I'd be lying if I said I knew this was a Prince song when I first heard this song. It was later on.
Yeah, when did Prince release his version? I feel like it was before our conscious really paying attention to music.
It's probably on. Yeah, I'd have to do some digging, but that's what the internet's for. We can find out.
My quick thought on it says he gave it a respectable amount of time, like 10 to 15 years, before he started anecdotally letting it be known that it was his. Maybe I'm wrong in saying that, because like you listen to it and it's clearly a Prince song now, right? Just even hearing her sing it, it's like, oh, well, that's obviously a song written by Prince. But it's because his version is whatever. It's just better because he's Prince. You know, just it unfortunately is what it is. But I think he waited a while before he made it known. I could be wrong in saying that.
Well, according to Wikipedia, Nothing Compares to Your song written by Prince for his side project, The Family. The song appeared on their 1985 debut album, The Family.
Okay.
Is this the version that we may know? I guess there's only one Prince version of this song. And if that's the case, yeah, this thing had existed about 5 years before O'Connor did the cover.
So it's a cover. Yeah, Sinead O'Connor's song is a legit cover. I thought that Prince was kind of covering a song that he wrote for Sinead O'Connor is what was in my head, but that's something entirely different.
I'm guessing it was not a big release. Like it was a song on an album that didn't get radio play.
Even says here it was not released as a single and received little recognition.
But give a song to
Prince. Prince had recorded a demo of the song earlier in 1984, which was not released until April 2018 as a digitally released posthumous single. But I feel like we'd heard a Prince version of the song before 2018, I think.
Yeah,
sort of all blends together. But Prince released. Okay, Prince released his own version of the song in 1993. Outside of the family version.
Okay. Is that the more popular version? Is that the one that we're familiar with?
That is probably the one that we have heard the most. It did chart a little bit from the looks of it.
So let me ask this. What other Sinead O'Connor songs... Was this Sinead O'Connor's first, like... not necessarily hit song, but was it the first song that made us aware that she existed as an artist? What song came out before this?
How was she bigger in her home country? And we're just putting our American red, white, and blue glasses on and saying she was a one-hit wonder because she only did a one hit here in the U.S.
I 100% believe that to be true. I think she's Irish, right? Is she on?
Yes.
Where's she from?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. So what I can see is that she found in a B-side Prince song that she performed well, and
now to be fair, her
blew up. But is this? Yeah,
her discography only starts a year before this song.
Right. Oh, really?
Yeah. That's not to say. I think I skimmed over some stuff about her being in a band. maybe with some, you know, other people. But
was she just like riding the coattails of the Cranberries, you think?
In the 80s. I think the Cranberries might have rode the coattails of her. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Too, well, you know, it's different styles, a little more poppy, but
okay, yeah. So what put her on? U2? Energy from U2? For her to have just like, this isn't her only hit, is it really?
It's subjective, isn't it? No, but we'll go back to the discography.
Yeah, I can't
Nothing
think
compares
of
to you.
Okay, but I think that still answers my question. At the end of the day, it's still her first hit, even if it's not her only one. It's her first hit, and I didn't realize that was the case. I kind of always, when I became familiar with the Prince story, I kind of thought it was a Sinead O'Connor existed type of a thing, and then she made a recording of this song written by Prince, which pushed her further into the stratosphere. Like, she became a name that Gen X will never forget, right? For whatever she is, even if I'd never heard that Prince story, I would still know who Sinead O'Connor was, you know, because this song, apparently just the strength of this one song.
How much do you think her haircut plays into this?
A lot.
It made her so recognizable, and so many people talked about her hairstyle.
Let me ask you this. So when you think Sinead O'Connor, what's the first... I'll tell you the first thing that I think of. I feel like I could like ask a question that leads us nowhere, so I'm just going to say what I think of when I think Sinead O'Connor, and it's that SNL, that famous SNL performance, right?
Right. But even before that, shaved head is the first thing I think about.
Yeah, you can't think of Sinead O'Connor without thinking, like, if you see a lady walk, if like you have a friend who shaves their head, the first thing you're going to do is call him Sinead O'Connor,
especially in the 90s. Like, maybe not as much now, right? But
yeah, it'd be a little bit more especially in the 90s. Cancer.
Yeah, okay, sure. Maybe,
but
yeah, even with still, that, when I say SNL, I'm still thinking like shaved head, that image of her, and this video, right? So there's the SNL thing, and this video.
That's Cass and I talked about that earlier in the week. Is she's famous for two things: is covering a Prince song and getting banned from Saturday Night Live.
Okay, yeah. There it is. So, yeah, damn, I didn't realize that one hit wonder Sinead O'Connor, whose one hit is the Prince song.
So are you a one hit wonder? If you're
on an international level.
If your one hit is not written by you, are you still a one hit wonder? Yeah, I guess so, because there's plenty of people that don't write their own songs. But yeah, it's a cover, and that's a different
Right. Yeah, that's
so that adds a different layer to it.
That's like if Eminem had his one song was Ice Ice Baby.
Right.
Oh, that's fair enough. That's interesting. I've got to believe that she...
When she released this song, no one had really heard the Prince version, and that makes a layer of complexity to it.
My thing is, when she released this song, had anyone heard the anything version of Sinead O'Connor, and did anyone listen to the anything version of Sinead O'Connor afterwards? Even in Ireland, was she famous in Ireland before this? Does she continue to sell out concerts in Ireland off the strength of the catalog and not off the strength of this singular song? And those are things that we probably won't figure out tonight. But that I feel like that's what defines her as a
woman. Yeah, we've got to find out what her footprint in Ireland is.
I know she had a small bump from. Conor McGregor played her as his entrance for some time. Like, that's what he came out to, was a Sinead O'Connor sang version. I don't know what it was. It was something that was very Irish in its nature. It was no. It was something completely different, but I wish I could I wish I could find the reference.
There she is.
But there she is tearing up a picture of the Pope. Which is not a big deal at all, really, today. I don't that would not she wouldn't get banned today for that, doing that.
No, that's because he's a religious figure, and you can offend religious people. That's a whole. Don't get me started on that. But religion.
It's okay outside of the scope of this people. Video. It's okay to offend Christian-based religious people. But
ooh, how about that? That's yeah.
Yeah, agreed. But that is outside of the scope of this video. That'll be for a different day, and we will move on to the next song on 60 songs that explain the 90s.
Yeah, one more time, shout out to Sinead O'Connor.
Yep, rest in peace.
Beautiful voice, rest in peace.
Indeed, rest in peace. I liked this song. This is late 90s.
Yeah.
This is... It fits in that category of like... Who's some other guys? Those guys that sing like the soundtrack to Cars from Disney. Like it's a lot of...
Oh,
The Life is a Highway, guys.
Yeah,
sure. Yeah.
That song. That I think Bill the one Collins. In Cars is a cover of another one hit wonder's version of that same song.
Yeah, I'm with you on that.
That which is interestingly thematically it lines up with what we were just talking about.
Yeah,
but as for the New Radicals, they had a few hits. They're a few hit wonders.
I could name a single one of their songs, but I'll automatically recognize this one. And you're right, I dug it. I like the intro. It sounds good.
You know what it is as soon as the intro starts playing. Mm-hmm. And the video is kind of fun because malls were a huge deal.
Oh, yeah, they were.
In the 80s and 90s.
I spent some time in the mall today.
Good point, Cass. Like, it's cool to... see people having fun at a mall.
Yeah, that I am. Yeah, so I was in the mall today walking around. I was like, yeah, I was a total effing mall rat. It's weird though. Like, I was walking through the mall, right? And like, old people were walking around the mall because it's like Thursday and it was the middle of the day. And I was walking through the mall. Of course, the old people were in there doing laps. And I could tell, like, you know, you can tell, like, the vibe you're putting down within a social circle. I could tell that I was acknowledged by all the senior citizens walking. I was moving around a little bit better than them, but I 100% felt like they felt like I was a part of their community walking through the mall. And that was a level of weirdness that I haven't taken a second to process for real. But there was a moment where I'm walking around the mall. Someone made a comment like, oh, I wish I was still getting around like you. Something an old lady legitimately like had this conversation about my ability to walk as I'm walking through the mall with my, you know, Fitbit on, gray AF because I haven't shaved my beard in a while. Total mall rat in my head, but senior citizen to the masses. That's just something to say about Gen X in 2023 versus what's going on here.
Mall
is what I felt like I was. That's what I felt like my vibe was. I'm just a dude in the mall. I'm an old school mall rat. And I'm just an old mess dude.
No, Art.
Yeah, when after I had my back surgery and I had to walk 2 miles a day, I would go on my lunch break because I was right down the road from the mall.
Sure.
And yeah, I would go because it was air conditioned. It was freaking hot outside. So I would just go to the mall and run, you know, walk some laps around the mall to get my 2 miles in for my recovery.
Nice, safe air conditions.
Mm-hmm.
Nice, safe air conditions.
But no arcade, no record store, no bookstore, no toy store, no electronics store for video games. It's a sad place. It's a sad place to me now, because as a nostalgic guy, and that used to be a passive novelty. Now it's the most fun place in the mall.
When I was in college and I would have a long break, I'd have an 8 o'clock class and my next class wouldn't be till like noon or 1 o'clock. Instead of going home, I would go to the mall. I'd, you know, go get something to eat, walk around, check out some stores, go to the music store.
But if you're not like a clothing buff or whatever terminology I'm looking for,
yep,
there's just nothing to kill. Yeah, if you're not a fashionista. There's
what's the male version of a fashionista?
Maybe, I don't know. But there's not much to kill time with if you're not.
Is the Spencer's gift, because we didn't have a Spencer's gift for the longest time. And then I went to the mall a couple of years ago, and there was a Spencer's Gifts in our mall.
I feel like it's gone already. It didn't last long.
Aww. Okay, because I will say, like, I saw it, and I'm like, oh, man, I should love going to Spencer's Gifts. I walked in as a 40-year-old. It is a totally different vibe, and you feel super creepy.
Hot Topic is that same thing. Like, man,
I bounced out of there so quick.
Hot Topic for a while was in the spot where Fines used to be, you know, where my store used to be. And we were a skater hip-hop store. Right, I'm like, oh hell yeah, this is the same place I would have been. But now I'm just some old dude now.
Well, for me, it's like a mixture of feeling creepy and feeling offended is not the word, but like troubled. That's the word I'm looking for. I'm like, oh yeah, man, why can people just come in and look at this? This is not appropriate.
That's how you know we're old.
Yeah,
there's a feeling of the store being inappropriate.
Yeah, all the stuff that used to be funny to us is now like almost gross.
My tolerance for inappropriate content is still the same. It doesn't offend me by any means. It's inappropriate to me in that it's so visible for young kids.
That's exactly the feeling I have too.
Yeah, it's right there in clear eye shot of super young kids, and it's some stuff that it just shouldn't be that way. Like, that's the inappropriate nature of it. I think the store has a right to exist. I would love walking through there. I don't like that I see 5-year-olds, 7-year-olds walking through there seeing some of that stuff.
Right. CNC Music Factory is an interesting case study in that this album featured the talents of What You See, but the follow-up album from CNC Music Factory did not feature the same talent that you see here. They were, and their name was not deceptive in any way. They were the Music Factory, so there was no guarantee of a Freedom Williams in the next album, but because of that, I feel like they're kind of an interesting whatever.
What was that second song, The New Radicals?
Yeah, New Radicals, Get What You Give.
Okay. I'm going to say CNC Music Factory, I was more than content to continue to have a conversation over this song without ever acknowledging them. And that's how I feel about it. I think that they are 100% as much as any other song that will be on this list. They have a place on the list, but I could forever go without ever hearing this song again, and I felt that same way back in the 90s. I never loved it, but I never disliked it.
Continuing the theme of
MTV loved it.
Yeah, MTV loved it, and continuing the theme of like one hit wonder asterisk, right? Because the talent you see in this video may have never been seen again, as far as I know.
Okay, right on.
But the only other somewhat single of popularity I know came from the Buffy the Vampire Slayer the movie soundtrack, and again featured a completely different ensemble of musical talent.
Gotcha.
But yes, you could not escape this song. That's for sure.
You couldn't escape it. What you're saying about them, like them not being a specific group with specific people performing the songs, it was legit just a factory of artists, I guess is what CNC Music Factory was.
That's my take.
Was a production studio or production company that just released tracks or released albums with various artists.
It's like a glorified demo or something, right?
Sure. I had no idea, not for real, other than I feel like I've heard you kind of mention that multiple times over the decades.
Yeah.
Not like you're passionate about it.
One of those little facts you happen to know.
Right. But
more God, from
I could go without them. I could always go without them.
Oh, sorry, she's not on the list. Oh, but you guys are gonna no. Well, maybe I don't know, but this is not the next song on the list.
That's going to be on the list, though. That song's going to be on the list. It's got to be, right? I mean, don't tell me, but that's my guess. Toni Braxton, "Unbreak My Heart," shows up.
From "Nothing Compares to You" to "Nothing But a G Thing."
Let's go. Yeah, give me something. Let's go.
Yeah, I don't even know if I have to state my affinity for this song.
I feel like there are multiple other occasions of us talking at length about this specific song and the
for no good reason at all.
For no good reason, for just the massive impact that it had.
This song is the catalyst.
I could be wrong. Somebody more knowledgeable can be like, no, this was. But I'm like, for me, this was like, pull the curtain back. We got a new genre that you're about to fall in love with.
I feel like, and I've used this analogy before. There's a line from Mos Def has this line where he's talking about the Twin Towers. You know, it's like the second plane that made the towers face off, or took the towers face off, or whatever he said. But essentially, the first plane, we really didn't know what was going on. The second plane, like, oh Jesus Christ, this is real, right? Mm-hmm. Dre Day was the first plane. Nothing But a G Thing was the second one. Like, okay, it's over. It's for me, it's Snoop, right? Whoever this dude is that's with Dre, it's him. That when Nothing But a G Thing came out, it was a wrap. I was a wrap. I'm team Snoop Dogg for the next 4 years.
And what was that? It was what, Deep Cover? Was that the song that they did before this?
So there was released Deep Cover, which was on a soundtrack.
Deep Cover.
Cop Killer was the, I think that was the name of it, Cop Killer or something like that, was on the Deep Cover soundtrack. That was the intro to Snoop Dogg. And then The Chronic came out with its first two singles, Dre Day and Nothing But a G Thing, right? But I really didn't pay attention to that Deep Cover soundtrack. Dre Day.
Well, that's because the movie didn't garner a lot of attention, like most soundtrack movies would have. I love that this version of the video has the blurred out hats.
Yeah. In my mind, it was the third song, right? I had no idea that it was the first because it got so little airtime. Like the movie didn't do all that well.
Right.
Like, it was just like this little hidden gem that just kind of set out there. It's such a good song.
So respect to this era, right, where they would put out an edited version of the video and an edited version of the song. We've talked about this before, where
And it wasn't lazy.
Or whoever it was.
It wasn't lazy. They actually rewrote the version. They wrote new verses. I say that about the hats and the everything else, right? Because, you know, as a young kid in the 90s, you're like, what is the hat? Like, you don't know. Or, I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, some of us don't know.
Yeah, you're going exactly to another point I was making about this song is, like, getting the unedited version of the song was a thing, but getting an unedited version of this video was a thing, right? Shout out to Derek B.
Oh man, somehow in the Derek B and rewatch that volleyball scene.
Yeah, right, yeah. who knows how little country Derek B in backwoods Alabama was able to come across an unedited version of this video
before the internet.
That's a good point. Somebody with one of those massive 6 foot satellite dishes getting some feed from somewhere recorded on a VHS.
What was that channel, The Box, where you could pay for them to play your video? You would like call a number, enter a code.
That's a thing. I didn't
enter
know
a code on the phone, and it would then it would play your video after you paid however much it cost.
I had no idea that that's how that worked, but I remember The Box being a thing. That's funny.
I was fascinated by satellite dishes in the 90s and had very little experience with them.
I think you could like buy a VHS copy of videos. That's what it was. Like, at
some music stores would sell them.
At music stores, you could buy a copy of the video, and I think that's what he had.
You legitimately had to be 17 or 18 to buy it. They weren't just handing them out. Most of the time, anyway.
That song just makes brought up my whole energy level. I feel like my serotonin levels are up right now.
That song, like I said earlier, it just gives me the feels, man. I don't even know. I can't explain it. It just takes me back to happy memories.
It does. It takes you just...
And so I played that
weird song about being a G in the California in the 90s made our... takes us back to being 13-year-old kids that just in a good mood for no reason.
Mm-hmm. Hey, one
all you kids that watch The Voice, this is where Gwen Stefani came from.
Right on.
She actually was a punk rocker, like a credible punk rocker at one point.
Yeah, then she went solo and did pop.
So,
and this was absolutely how people dressed in the 90s.
Yeah. That punk / skater culture. I did not love this song.
I didn't either.
I'm just about to say I'm kind of glad the song is on the list, though.
It's another one that has a
it deserves it. Place.
It deserves it, but I didn't care for it. I didn't necessarily see her. I never really saw them as a punk group in the same ways as.
I love Spiderwebs, by the way, from the same album.
Yeah, Spiderwebs is also a good song. There was something that
and there was that one other one
always felt popish about them. Like she always seemed like a pop singer with a punk vibe.
And they got a lot of play in pop radio and that kind of thing too. They were once they. Arrived, they quickly became a mainstream thing.
So I feel like the same energy as why can't I think of their names? Who are the other ones where the lead singer showed up in Friends from time to time? Why can't I think of those guys' names? The most popular punk band of the 90s, Green Day. So I feel like there's some Green Day energy.
But I can kind of see that.
But not as. That's not true. I can't say not as authentic. That's not true. I just don't. I didn't rock. I didn't vibe with them like I did with some others. But I wasn't really here for the pop scene in the 90s to talk in the first place. Like just a little bit.
Yeah, in the 90s when No Doubt first came out, I was reluctant to give them a chance. Like I would. Often say this terrible joke like, oh, No Doubt they suck.
I never disliked them, but I mean let's reality check for a second here. We're three guys saying we wouldn't have picked the song Just a Girl to go on the list over some of their other stuff.
Oh, I'm not saying that at all,
but we recognize that it deserves to be on here.
Yeah,
well, right, like I'm saying No Doubt is not on Daniel's personal list, but yeah, okay, this is the essential No Doubt song. No Doubt, no pun intended about that. And yeah, I'm sure, like, you know, girl power and all. This is probably more appreciated than we realize.
You know who they are to me? I'm gonna go with Amy. Loves them, right? She's about 3 years younger than us. You know what I mean? I feel like that song and their energy and their vibe. Hit more along the lines of the Spice Girls than it did for real punk energy. You know what I mean? I think like the 12 and 13 year olds liked them just as much as their peers. That's my take on them. I think they're just fine as a band. They're just fine.
I appreciate them a lot more now than I did.
From No Doubt 90s. To No Scrubs, but keeping the girl power strong from video to video here.
I can never hear this song. Yeah, I know you've heard me say this before several times, Daniel. I can't hear this song without immediately being transported back to Panama City Beach with Travis Chambers and Derek B. And we're cruising the strip with this damn song playing because Travis loved it.
I love Travis. Let me preface what I'm about to say with, you know, send him his flowers before I finish the sentence or whatever. Travis had a tendency to pick the most non-masculine songs to fall in love with and blast over his stereo. I have other examples that I can't, like, I don't have the specific song, but I remember we were listening to this soundtrack that had like this awesome Method Man song on it, and he picked the No Scrubs of that album, and that was his song. And I was like, bro, can we listen to the Method Man song? This is an interesting choice, isn't it? Over Waterfalls? Am I alone?
No, if Waterfalls isn't on the list and this is, then that's insane.
Yeah, Waterfalls has to be on the list.
Yeah, there's got to be both of them.
And there's TLC, no way they're putting TLC on here twice.
You don't think they should?
TLC is the most successful female group of all time. Before, so I guess.
I wouldn't be surprised if we don't see some from their first album.
I was going to say, it's possible TLC's on here three times. In my opinion, I feel like they're that big of a deal.
I played their first album out.
I agree with you, Kaz. If No Scrubs is on there, I think Waterfalls should certainly be on there. And then
Ain't Too Proud to Beg.
Ain't Too Proud to Beg is another early to mid-early 90s, just a real hit. That is worthy. It's as worthy as the Breeders' Cannonball or Smashing Pumpkins' Mayonnaise.
Oh yeah.
Well,
I would easily bump those for TLC songs.
I'm just saying. I don't see. I mean, we're early in the list. We're probably approaching number 20, but that's the third of the list. There's not been a repeat.
Of an artist,
and I don't expect a repeat of an artist. So,
okay, wow. Interesting. I would say that Janet Jackson, Michael Jackson, TLC. Who else could have a repeat? Who else could have a repeat?
But I would,
Alan Jackson,
Metallica.
I would bump this song. I mean, if we only have 60 songs to represent the 90s, I would bump this and put in Waterfalls.
I'm like 60 songs. There's got to be some repeat artists.
And believe me, some of it's self-inflicted, but I am well sick of the song Waterfalls in my life. But
like already, you're still done with ever hearing it again. And right. I kind of agree with you, even though I loved it and played it out.
And I love it. I've voluntarily played it many times, but I would never need to hear it again. I would still put it on this list.
Isn't it up with like near the top of the most or the longest number, number one songs?
I could see that.
Waterfalls.
Like, I can see it.
I believe it was on the chart, or at least it was on the chart for a very long time.
I can't accept anything but Waterfalls as TLC's biggest song and therefore most impactful for the 90s.
No contest. No contest.
I have a hard time accepting that No Scrubs is on this list and TLC doesn't have two songs on the list. I have a hard time accepting that. That completely invalidates the list to me if Waterfalls isn't on here.
we'll circle back to this. Here's an interesting way to sneak in Soundgarden and Pearl Jam into the list without actually putting Soundgarden or Pearl Jam in the list. Is this weird?
This was their joint venture?
This was that weird one-off joint venture.
So I remember that it was a thing, but I think I should just shut up because I have zero opinions whatsoever, and I can already tell you this doesn't sound familiar to me.
Oh, really?
Not right now. Maybe in a minute.
Was this on a soundtrack, or was this just something they did?
Let's...
Like a crossover?
I should know the answer to this as the alt-rock aficionado of the group, probably, but let's see. So this is a full-on album, right? Well, a 10-track album with some outtakes released much later on. And I wasn't even for sure about that because Hunger Strike is the only thing that I know from this collaboration. MTV also loved this song. And I was at that, like, MTV was like, you know, had that little bit of hipster punk rock energy going on in the early 90s. So they loved showing you this stuff, right? And I just never appreciated it when it was new. Nowadays I can listen to it and I'm like, this is a really good song. And I kind of, you know, I get why it's on this list for the reasons I've said. It's like, it's a very interesting, it's like, it's grunge. It's Seattle grunge with two of the like premier voices of Seattle grunge, of Chris Cornell and Eddie Vedder.
It's a song you can sing along to without knowing any of the words.
So I have heard it in bars, right? I've never really, like, I guess, like, I kind of remember this sound from the 90s, but not for real. I would say that I rarely, if ever, would have continued watching this video all the way through.
And this will be my first time making it through.
Sure. And on video shows where this would have been played, potentially, I don't want to make any assumptions. I know it's not 100% true because we're children of the same generation. There were times when it comes to like digesting music where MTV would be too far off in a genre that I didn't want to get 100% of.
Yeah.
This.
Yeah. That's fair.
Where I'd switch over to BET and I could trust BET to have solid music on during the afternoons as well. So
or VH1.
You know, VH1, once we hit our 20s, because I really didn't mess with VH1 too tough until like I got out of school.
Actually, VH1 might not have existed for us when this video was out.
Sure.
Until I was later VH1 90s. VH1
for a pop-up video.
Pop-up video. So pop-up video started catching our attention right then.
Right.
VH1 had this really cool, like, early, like, there was Insomnia music. I think that was VH1, right?
Yeah.
And then there was that early morning music show that they would have where I would listen to music before going to work, right? But VH1 was like music at obscure times when you couldn't really trust MTV to have anything, and BET certainly wouldn't have anything, you know, unless it was like BET After Dark eventually. The VH1 had their moment when I was an air quote adult, aka early 20s.
It's still crazy to think that there used to be just blocks of time on MTV where they were basically a radio station playing music videos.
The idea that it's not that I still haven't come to terms with, which is why I don't F with MTV to this day, because I remember what it was. It's like having a first love that becomes like a crackhead.
Yeah,
like, I don't even want to be around you. I just want to remember you for what you were.
You burned me too bad for me to ever rekindle any relationship.
Yeah, I don't mess with MTV at all or BET. And I'm kind of interested in going back to BET just because, you know, that's for some different reasons.
See what, what's his name?
See what Tyler Perry does with it for the culture. But, you know, maybe we'll see. BET lost me for the culture, and MTV lost me because of the music thing.
We went from Headbangers Ball to Yo MTV Raps.
Let's go, Juicy. Like, yeah, this is a song by Big, right? This is a song by Biggie.
Is this the one you would put on the list?
Okay, yes, but not really, right?
I think Hypnotized would have been my, like,
right. That's
you're reading my mind, right? Hypnotized is the one that I think the masses of our generation would recognize because it was it's probably the Biggie video, right?
Right.
It's been in so many movies.
It's like you hear like 2 seconds of the music and you know what you're listening to.
You know exactly what it's the definitive. What's the word I'm looking for? A commercial hit song for him. But Juicy is everything, right? Juicy is one of his best deliveries in a way that's not off-putting. It's in a way that's commercially acceptable, but not commercially marketed.
I was going to say, lyrically, I may like it better.
Yeah, lyrically, he's always lyrically on point.
All right.
But it's a great story. It's an inspirational song at the same time. And then shout out to Puffy for his Making the Band, who iconically required that first Making the Band group that was a hip hop group. He made them, memorize the song for real, which gave it like this cult, this level of cult respect, where it's like, if you're a real hip hop head, then you should know the words to Juicy, right? Because that was one of the trials that the people had to go through in this Making the Band episode, and it became that was off the like MTV at the height of its powers as well. So this song has a cultural impact, and that was that same season with Dylon, who Dave Chappelle is also kind of famously immortalized, right? So that season of Making the Band is immortalized because of what it was for MTV and hip hop. And then Dave Chappelle further cemented it, and then this song benefits from that. So yeah, Juicy for the win. Biggie's song, with all due respect to Hypnotize. If it was the best video, it would be Hypnotize.
Such a shame what happened, though. Side note, kind of related. You guys see they served a search warrant in the Tupac murders?
Is that what? Right?
Yeah, they've started moving on Tupac, on the Tupac murders again.
Interesting. Interesting.
I mean, if there's things to know, then we should know them, but it is a little strange to be even considering such a thing this far out.
I mean, it sounds like, at least with the Tupac, that people have been investigating it on and off since it happened. I mean, look at the movies and things that still come out.
We're really, really shifted up for a second. Our first country, is this our first country entry to this list? Play on the Simply Irresistible by that guy from the 80s that I can't remember his name now.
In Canada,
Canadian country star. I was totally content to watch Shania Twain.
Yeah,
all day long.
Yeah,
all day long. Let me tell you, like Corey, I don't know how it happened, but my Shania Twain story is that for whatever reason, Corey ended up telling one of our friends, a black guy, that Shania Twain's husband or was dating a black guy. For whatever reason, Corey tells this guy that Shania Twain's dating this black guy, right? And he wasn't telling me, it was all a joke, right? He was just getting a kick out of telling this guy that, because the guy got super excited for whatever reason, right? And I say for whatever reason somewhat like ironically, because the reason is that it was a little bit exciting to me as well, for whatever reason. I was like, hell yeah, Shania.
So you're saying there's a chance.
Yeah, Shania's down for the team. Okay. So I didn't find out for like 2 decades. It was within like the past 10 years that it came up, and like I said it around them, where for whatever reason, because shit like it comes up around that group of people. It was, yeah, Shania, I like Shania Twain because she's down for the team, right? And Corey's like, what? And I told him, I was like, yeah, I heard that something. He's like, what? That's a such a person. And I felt like the biggest fool. But I always loved her a little bit extra because of it. always, always, because she's fun to look at. We'll just leave it there. I'm like talking low because Amy just walked by, and even though it's not that big of a deal, right, nobody wants to hear that. I can be, I can be respectful in that way, but damn, Shania.
There were a handful of I'm gonna try so hard to not get distracted while I talk this out, but it certainly helped the ratings for CMT and anything to do with country music that there were a handful of lovely ladies that emerged in the 90s in the country music scene.
Yeah. But I think she was second to none, just in terms of on screen.
Oh yeah, she was the front runner, I believe. I can't think of anyone.
So there's her, and then Faith Hill, and then who are some other
Faith
ones?
Hill. Now it came much later on, but I mean, still to this day, you can get Carrie Underwood to do the Sunday Night Football thing, and I'll pay close attention.
I got her like in that same generation, because of the way time works, I guess. When does Carrie Underwood?
I think Carrie comes actually much later.
Yeah, she was on American Idol.
That's right. So much later.
Right, but she's been the voice of Monday Night Football for how long, and been
for
awesome
years now.
Since Hank Williams said something stupid and got dropped.
Oh, right. I forgot about old Hank. Yeah.
That's over 10 years now for sure. Right. I love her intros, but you know, I like those Hank Williams intros as well. But they've stepped it up with her. But on Shania with me, I feel like.
We're really taking some wild adventures tonight as far as genre hopping. I hate the name of this song because I like this song. Now this is an interesting
Tool song?
Yeah, this is a Tool song. This is interesting. I mean, do you guys remember these Tool videos? They were, and you're about to see, they were like,
I
felt uncomfortable watching them. They were like creepy enough to where I'm like, oh, maybe go do something else for a minute.
Yeah, that's a cool
video. Yeah, no, I did not watch these Tool videos.
I don't know if this is going to be one of the... Oh, so this isn't like the Tool video that I remember. Like the one was the one that was like claymation, weird puppet stuff going on.
I'm with you. Yeah, for sure. For sure.
So this is another artsy, creepy, weird video, obviously. It's probably hard to understand most of what he's saying, but lyrically, this is a... it's a good song with a super unfortunate name. This might be the one that... Like, it took a long time to actually know the name of the song because I didn't buy any Tool albums because they were way too creepy. But this like rock riff that's going on right here, like this is a very good guitarist in Tool. And the writer, lead singer Maynard Keegan is an incredibly good songwriter. But MTV, I think it's this one just because of the name of it. They weren't allowed to say the name of the song. So this was always like, if you know, MTV always had the name of the song in the corner. Mm-hmm. This was just called track two because this was the second track on the album. So for most of us that didn't really know who Tool was, the name of this song is track two.
That's funny.
Yeah, it's funny because, I mean, funny you say that. Yeah, the Blink 182 song, what was it, Damn It?
Yeah.
They wanted to call it Damn It, Son of a Bitch, based off of the Beavis and Butthead.
Is that right?
But it didn't clear, so they had to just drop it down.
They lowered it, huh? Mm-hmm. That's true, because, and similar to this song, like, the name of the song has nothing to do with the song. Likewise with that Blink 182 song.
I honestly, I'd heard Tool on, you know, every now and then. I didn't really start paying them attention until Johnny Cash covered Hurt. And then I feel like Johnny Cash did a better version of the song.
This is...
But mainly going back to what you were saying, their videos creeped me out.
Well,
so I didn't give them a chance.
Yeah, even if you're just like, okay, well, I mean, don't get me wrong. I watched horror films and stuff, but, or at least at that age, you know, like your basic, you know, Amityville's and Candyman's and stuff. So this is not like I couldn't handle the video, right? But like, you watch the video once, and you know, like, it's not like watching a Shania Twain video. Like, what is there to?
There's no enjoyment coming.
Like, right? Like, you're not having a good time right now. You know what I'm saying?
Unless you really love the song, maybe. Like, right?
But I guess, right? But even then, I like the song. I like the song a lot, but not enough to endure. If I have to watch this every time I hear the song, then I'm a one and done.
It's like hot wings where you could get like Atomic Super Spicy, or you could get something, a milder version with just the same amount of flavor.
Right, right. Yeah, give me something a little more palatable.
This is my first time seeing this video. I'm watching it intently. I'm with you. I feel confident that I didn't watch it when I had the opportunity, so I don't know what to say about whether or not how I would have felt about it then. I feel
like
the fact that I've never seen it is saying enough.
Right. I like, and again, I do like the song. I think the other two, if we were gonna, and the list doesn't specify if we're talking videos or songs, but that other Tool video I think was a little more like memorable.
Well, that was good. Yeah, that's my question though. Like, is this the definitive Tool song, Stinkfist?
Oh, and you know, I don't want to like spend extra time on Tool, but this is, you know, just this is that video, you know, with the little, yeah.
Yeah, I'm with you. Yeah.
While I bring up the next song.
I feel like that's the more popular song.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, still creepy and still off-putting, but a little more off-putting. Feels like some Edgar Allan Poe stuff going on right now with this video.
Mm-hmm. And didn't Metallica have a weird claymation video, like one or something?
I feel it's got to be like
it's
the same director,
very possible.
Right? I think that's true.
I don't know what this is. Guys, this is the first song on this list that I'm like, I don't know this band or this song. Let's see if we do. This is a British pop band. Signature anthem. Common people discussing layers of class criticism in his lyrics.
They're getting a red flag just off the jump. To be clear, this is the first song that I've flagged so far.
This is, you got two challenges and six amongst us.
And on some sneaky stuff, I've also got, who was it? Oh, I didn't put TLC on here. What's missing? TLC No Scrubs,
No Doubt before that with Just a Girl.
Well, Just a Girl deserves to be on there.
Oh, definitely.
I've got
saying No Scrubs is like a right band, wrong song kind of thing.
Yeah, right band, wrong song. They got the yellow light right
here. I put Temple of the Dog Hunger Strike on a red card because I think it's a pretentious pick when Eddie Vedder from Pearl Jam and Chris Cornell with Soundgarden have like a massive library of essential music Jeremy and gosh, Black Hole Sun or Rusty Cage or just so much from Chris Cornell's a genius songwriter, and all he does is say I'm going hungry for 3 minutes straight in this Temple of the Dog song.
So Jeremy and Black Hole Sun, I feel like are both no-brainers in my opinion, but
Black Hole Sun's one of my least favorite Soundgarden songs, but I still, you know, again, you recognize what should be there.
Yes, exactly. I'm 100% going it should be there. There's so many songs.
Did you say this was like a social commentary song?
Just going off what I have to work with here, which is a brief description of the reason that this song made the list without listening to the whole 44-minute commentary on it.
I'm bumping this for rage.
Well, you know, we have not skipped a single song or video on this list so far, so I wasn't going to let this be the one where we do.
Oh, yeah, yeah, no. It's
a great chance for us to talk about things that maybe shouldn't be on this list. Now, if we lived in Britain, would we feel differently?
It's possible, yeah.
But in the American
slant, because I'm an American, I'm going something from Rage Against the Machine or Green Day.
We may yet get a chance to, if we don't get Bulls on Parade or something on here, I'll feel a little bit like maybe that was a missed opportunity.
Yeah, or Public Enemy.
I'm reserving my rage until the end, but this is certainly flagged.
This is an artsy pick. Also, like, it's not like we didn't have... If a song was good enough, we would have heard it, right?
Yeah, this, you know, didn't come across the pond. Because we even got, which obviously it's not a 90s song, but we got a song that's completely in Korean that was like a huge, massive hit here. And we didn't even know what the man was saying.
One time for the internet in regards to that, though.
And his dance.
Let's get Bat Dance. Bat Dance deserves to be on there.
It's not on there, but...
It should be. But it should be.
But it definitely should be. Although, 80s song, though. Yeah, you know what it is? It's 1989. All right. Yeah, well, I don't want us to go out on that note. So I'll give us one more for this episode.
Let's go. Certainly. This was one of my first
love hate
pothead songs without smoking. This is a song that you couldn't tell me I wasn't a pothead without having ever smoked anything in my life.
This beat is there from the beginning.
Is there? I mean, this is top 10 coolest music track ever.
Yeah, agreed. I feel like this song is in the definitive.
They could have been rapping about doing your taxes and this song would have worked, because this beat, this music is so good. And yeah, I've always been anti-drug. I struggle to wonder if I've ever even been within a room of marijuana, right? But yeah, I would play this song. You couldn't. It was just too good.
I'm gonna plead the fifth in regards to my experiences.
Okay. Fair.
But at the time when I fell in love with this song, my experience was zero. And I loved it.
Coming from a very religious family in the South, Alabama. I got none of the references. No idea what they were talking about. But yeah, every CD I burned for a long time, especially when I had a system, this song made it. No doubt.
We need to be adding bass song, like asterisks by songs as well. Like, yeah, this song hit.
jeans with visible thongs are...
Never
out of style. One of the greatest ideas in the history of female outfits. I've got an interesting pondering about this song, right? This may be the first song on the list where I'm like, I don't know if I've ever seen this video. And yet I know that I've heard, hundreds at least of times played this song. Probably knew all the words at one point, but like I... So I'm like, how did I even hear this song? Because I don't remember ever seeing this video.
Right on. Okay, yeah, that's funny. I got you. That makes sense.
I would remember it just for the girls.
I was introduced to this song in somebody's car.
Right. We probably all, this is the way we're all riding around hearing bass music coming from other cars. I probably heard somebody else playing this and I'm like, what is that?
Because it sounded so effing good.
There is nothing about it that had this about like, it. I don't know, like, this is just like, it puts you in that like drive around at night kind of mood. To me,
oh my god, like leaving the bowling alley with a, for me there came a point where it's like whatever, okay,
I'm in the parking lot at I'm like getting off work at Food World when I hear this song, right? Like I'm in the parking lot just when life was just about playing loud music.
oh my god yeah, like I said, serotonin levels are up right now.
Yeah, it is crazy. Like you said, I had this memory. The first time I heard the song 85 South, we were down in Panama City, and somebody drove by playing that song, and it just hooked me instantly. And I never heard it before, so like I was asking people, like I was going around like asking people, "Hey, have you ever heard this song? It's like Riding Dirty on 85. Do you know what I'm talking about?" Until I finally got somebody to tell me, you know, who wrote, you know, what the song was, so that I could like go home, hop on Napster and download the song so I could have it.
Whatever producer put that music track together, I hope that they're a millionaire. One of the best ever.
One time for the Bay Area and that Bay Area vibe. I've talked about it before. I know we're about to call it short, but I got to give respect to the Bay Area and what they did for music. There's a difference between East Coast, West Coast, Southern, whatever. Then once you get to the West Coast and get to California, there's that Bay Area that you get with Digital Underground, Mooney's, Too Short, all of them, and those producers that have a little, it's not just funk, because LA has this funk vibe, but the Bay has like this funk with some swing to it that nobody else really has. And that's, I feel like that's what you're hearing there, and that's one of the iconic Bay Area funk swing sounds. The way that I feel right now is enough. I think we're all feeling that.
Exactly.
We needed that based off of Pulp and Common People, whatever the F that was.
Couldn't go out on that, so I had to send us out on one that'll keep us happy. Definitely. And yeah, you know, again, I struggle with like the message of the song, but gosh, it deserves to be on the list.
Somebody has sampled that beat in a current song, and I can't remember what it is now.
Well, it was definitely used in the marketing of
Us.
That's what it is. It's either Us or Them. It's Us though. It's Us.
Yeah.
It was used there, and it became like kind of maybe not TikTok famous, but social media famous around 3-4 years ago. Time flies when you're having fun. Let's say 2 to 3 years ago, when that movie came out, and it slowed down a lot and has like, I want to say like it's called Nightmare Mix or something else, but it's that same thing slowed down a lot, and that reintroduced it to the masses again, and that's where the song's a little bit more popular again as well, because it sounds good no matter what decade you're listening to it.
It's another one of those songs you hear the first three beats, you know exactly what it is.
Right.
We all recommend listening to it with some damn bass speakers in your car.
Oh my gosh. I can. At least one. Yeah. Like it has a bass line in it that you don't hear it unless you have the subwoofers. Like, I mean, you can, there's parts of it that you hear, but it has that like sneaky, like cool, like undertones of like deep, low hertz, long bass drives.
Like bass, you're like, damn, that's a bass song, and that's quadding, that's hitting all these bass levels. And sometimes a song that hits sounds like music, right?
Right.
And that song sounds like good music. Clean bass line.
It really the bass adds another instrument to the song if you have the subwoofers for it. Yes. Yes.
Agreed.
Well said.
Agreed.